A rebel took to the streets. He recruited others to join him. They roamed the hood and challenged authority. Community leaders feared them. Religious leaders abhorred them. "We have to get them off the streets," they said. But they weren't part of a gang spreading hate and terror. They were spreading love.
Good morning, Grace Church. I'm glad that you're here with us. These video clips that we've been using have been provided by the He Gets Us campaign. And I love them because they make me think about Jesus and what he did differently than I usually do. Because if you think about it, what we just watched with that video was that Jesus was a rebel. The people of the day, whether it was Rome or the Jewish authorities, he was this leader of some kind of rebellion that was pushing back against the norm, and they wanted to squish him. You know, we have multiple accounts of where people tried literally to stone Jesus because of his radical message. And what was his message? Love one another. Can you think about that? You know, we're known maybe in our area for having this, that, or the other gang. And one of those gangs, their gang sign is a heart, right? And that's their motto. We're going to love them all, right? That's what was being done here to Jesus. We don't think about it that way. But Jesus very, very much was a rebel, and he was viewed that way by the world around him. So if you're in this room and you're in a place where you've said, you know what, I follow Jesus. I've gotten to know who he is. I've accepted what he's done on my behalf, and I've chosen now to follow him. If you're a Jesus follower, if you're what we would call a Christian, you maybe have felt that. Why does the world hate me for doing good? Well, the thing is, you're not alone in that, because that's what happened to Jesus. But in the same breath, even if you haven't yet chosen to follow Jesus, maybe you're not even really sure about who this Jesus guy is or if you should follow him, the fact of the matter is that Jesus gets what it means to be an outcast. He knows what it's like to not be on the inner circle, but to be looked down upon. And because of that, we can say that he gets us. We can say that Jesus gets us. And this is not just a neat marketing ploy. This isn't just a slick campaign to rebrand Jesus that we're participating in, but this is something that I believe is deeply rooted in the truth of Scripture. You don't have to turn there, I'm just going to be there briefly, but in the book of Hebrews, which is one of the letters that were written in the New Testament of our Bibles, we read this in chapter 4. It says that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, and therefore we should hold fast to our confession. But catch that what comes next. It says, "For we do not have a high priest who was unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." This is a deeply biblical idea that Jesus gets us. He walks through this life just like we did. It's easy to put him off as this, well, if you know anything about Jesus, he's apparently God, right? Well, you know, if he's God, then how could he know what it's like to be me? Well, it's because he was God, and I will affirm that 6 ways to Sunday. But I will also equally strongly affirm that Jesus was 100% human. And because of that, he understands. He walked through it. You know, Jesus stubbed his toe. Have you ever thought about that? Jesus stubbed his toe. Now, I'm going to choose to believe he didn't drop any Jewish expletives at that point, but, you know, we know what it's like. Such a minor inconvenience can bring that out, that anger. I mean, what was that chair doing there? And I get mad at the chair and I start yelling at the chair, right? Because it's the chair's fault, right? Well, I don't know about any of you, but maybe you can sympathize with me. Today, I'm older than I was yesterday. Anybody else? Anybody else there with me? Okay, few of you. Norma's there with me. A few of you are just out to lunch. All right, that's great. I know you're thinking about the chili that's coming later today with our cook-off. I get that. But here's the thing. I've noticed that I've had a lot of tomorrows, meaning that I'm old, significantly older than I like to admit. I still in my brain act like a kid. My body sometimes tries to, you know, participate in physical activities like I were a kid. But the fact of the matter is I break way more easily than I used to. And this week, I had the wonderful experience of, we have a very old little Maltese dog, okay? This used to be a crazy, yippy, running all over the place. Martin knew my dog when he was younger, and he would just freak out all the time. Now he just kind of comes up, sniffs you, and then goes and lays back down, okay? He is old. He's at kind of the end of the life cycle, as it were. And he's kind of blind and kind of deaf, and yet he still tries to scarf for food. So I was preparing something in the kitchen, it was some kind of breakfast thing the other day, and the dog apparently came right up, because he's now blind and deaf, he wants to hang out right under your feet. But he doesn't make any sounds anymore, so you don't know he's there. So I went ahead and I turned around to walk, and here's a dog right here that I knew if I stepped on, remember he's 12 pounds, and we'll just say I'm significantly more than 12 pounds, okay? If I would have stepped on the dog, do you know what would have happened to the dog? You've heard the phrase, a dead dog, right? You know, that would have happened. And for whatever reason, I still love this dog like nobody's business. So I, of course, tried to leap and twist to get away from stepping on the dog, which just proceeded to have me smash my finger into a cabinet, rip off a big piece of skin there. I don't know if you can see it. I had this big contusion. It was like, you know, those cartoon ones where, you know, you could used to see a Bugs Bunny. It would go, you know, and raise. That's what happened. Like in 5 minutes, it was standing an inch off my arm. I fell down and my back has been nuts. If I turn my head too far that way, oh, it hurts. This body is breaking down, okay? Now, here's the thing. I've come to expect that, but when I think of Jesus, I don't think of Jesus as somebody who got old and things started to creak. But guess what? Now, he probably would have known the dog was there, would have definitely avoided it, you know, sure. But the thing is, Jesus stubbed his toe. Jesus fell down and got scrapes. Jesus had to walk through this. The very God who took on human flesh had to have other people change his diaper, okay? He had to learn how to talk. Jesus gets us because he walked through it with us. And I think as a result, we're going to see some really amazing truths this week and next and then to follow. And one of the reasons Jesus gets us is because Jesus accepts everyone. Now, I know some of you, a flag probably went up, right? Any of you ready to pick up something sharp and pointy, maybe throw it at me and say, that's not true. Jesus doesn't accept everybody. Don't raise your hands. Don't raise your hands. But let me circle back to that. Don't think that I've gone off some kind of crazy ledge here. But I believe this truth wholeheartedly, that Jesus does accept everyone. And we're going to get to why and what that acceptance means. But let me tell you, this again is biblical. If you go to Romans 2:11, it's a very short verse. It says this, "For God shows no partiality." God shows no partiality. And the thing is, this, if the Bible says it once, is that something we can rely on? I would say it's one of our beliefs, that God's absolutes are absolutely good. We believe in the truthfulness and the trustworthiness of Scripture. So if the Bible says it, we believe it, we can stand on it. The Bible doesn't say this once. At least four more times in the New Testament alone, we see this. We see it in Acts 10 with Peter, when God brings down all these different things that were formerly not acceptable for him to eat, and now it is, and all these different things. He has just incredible vision. Peter learned that God shows no partiality. And then again, in Galatians, Ephesians, and Colossians, three more letters from the Apostle Paul, he repeats almost verbatim this idea, God shows no partiality. There's five times in the New Testament where we're told God shows no partiality. And here's the kicker. This is one of those, well, that's sure nice of God, isn't it? In James chapter 2, verses 1 and 9, we read something which brings us to the same place that we're supposed to do the same thing. My brothers, James writes, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. So we're commanded not to do it, and then we're told if you do it, you're sinning. So God shows no partiality. Are we supposed to show partiality? No, these are the words of Scripture. Okay? If God shows no partiality, we have to put that in context. What does that mean for us? Well, let's flesh it out a little bit. I'm going to hop over to Galatians chapter 3. And in Galatians 3, you can turn there if you want. We're just going to look at a couple verses here. We're going to look at starting in verse 26. This is the Apostle Paul writing to the early Christians in the area of Galatia. And he says, in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God. So if you've chosen to follow Jesus, you are all sons, brothers and sisters, siblings. You are part of the family, and that happens through faith. Verse 27, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. That's the idea of that we have accepted who Jesus is and what he's done. If we're in that place, we're in the family. Verse 28, there is neither. This doesn't exist anymore. Talking about those who've come into Christ's family, there's neither Jew nor Greek. And you have to understand, this is talking about principles and kind of categories. Sometimes we get wrapped into the specifics. But why these are put in parallel, and this is a very Jewish thing to do, putting these kind of bookend ideas. Jew and Greek is talking about religious affiliation, like kind of what was your upbringing when it came to religion? Well, you were either a Jew or a pagan in the Jewish context. Well, that doesn't exist in God's family. He says there is neither slave nor free. This is a political distinction. This is talking into the Roman context. You know, are you part of the ruling elite or the subjugated? There are some estimates that anywhere between 70 and 90% of the ancient world were either in poverty or slavery at this point. So, but it, what Paul is saying is that doesn't matter. If you're in God's family, those distinctions don't matter. And then he goes and says, there is no male and female. And here we're talking about a biological distinction. You know, the other things are kind of socioeconomic or a belief system. Here you're talking about just physical reality. What he's saying, first of all, were there still men and women? If you come to faith in Jesus, does everybody become some kind of eunuch where all genitalia disappears? Does that happen? No. There is still male and female. What is he saying? That no longer divides us, that there is an equal playing field. And this was revolutionary in this day and this time where women were still in so many ways considered property, that they had very little rights and say in anything. This was an elevation saying that stuff, when you're in God's family, there is no partiality. You are equally accepted into God's family. And it says, for you are all one, you have this corporate community experience in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offsprings and heirs according to the promise. This is a little side note. You see, the scripture of the early church, do you know what the Bible was to the first Christians? Anybody know? Nobody. What, if Paul said you need to read your Bible, what was he telling people to read? The Torah, what we call the Old Testament. And that is, there are multiple times where in the New Testament, it talks about the Old Testament as this is good and right. Well, this is taking all the promises of the Old Testament and saying all those promised inheritances, what you get to be as part of God's family, you are the heirs, just like Jesus Christ, the Son of God. You enter into that as part of God's family, and there's no distinction. It's not like, well, you came in as a Jew, so you get the higher percentage. You came in as the Gentile, so you get the lower. There's none of that stuff. That's not how God operates. So this is what it means to be part of God's family. We've taken that step to trust Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins. But I think if we take a step back, we get a bigger picture of kind of how Jesus operates. So if you do have your Bibles, either, you know, your paper copies, you know, your troglodytes, or if you've got your electronic versions, open to Mark 2. We're going to look at just a handful of verses in Mark 2 to talk about what it means that Jesus accepts. And look here. Here's our first big idea. Jesus invites us into a relationship with him. This is so key. So much of what had come at the context when Jesus entered the world, religion was just that. It was sets of rules, of rituals that you performed either for social standing or to try to almost like a magic passphrase or magic spell to get what you wanted. It was transactional. What Jesus does is invite the world, rather than to step into religion, although there is religion that comes around this and helps support it, he invites us into a relationship. This was revolutionary. It's what the Jewish faith was all about, being invited in and called God's family, his people, his sons. That's what it was supposed to be about, but it became about religion and rules and rituals. Jesus invites into a relationship with him. So if you're with me in Mark chapter 2, we're going to start by looking at verse 13. And we read this: Jesus went out again beside the sea, and all the crowd was coming to him, and he was teaching them. This is the kind of the context. Jesus stepped into the role of the Jewish idea of the rabbi, of the one who could instruct others and would have those who would seek him for that instruction. As he passed by, as he was traveling along doing this teaching, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth. How many of you like paying taxes? Nobody? Susanna, seriously? There always has to be one. And Tiffany's not in the room, so you had to do it for me. Nobody likes paying taxes. We don't like, now we might like tax time if we're planning on getting a big refund, but we don't like paying taxes. And regardless of where you're at with that politically, we understand that there are certain things that, yes, we as a community need. But the whole thing is, we don't like paying taxes. But do you know what we like less than paying taxes? The people that make us pay taxes, right? You know, if I say, hey, I've got a friend in the IRS, he's going to come visit you. How many of you would be like, yay, IRS man? Anybody? No. And here's the thing. We kind of have this like suspicious eye. We think, you know, IRS people are probably, you know, all just a little bit less than human, right? We wouldn't admit it, but that's kind of how we're thinking, right? Well, in this context, those who were tax collectors, it wasn't just kind of like this assumption. Tax collectors were literally traitors to the Jewish nation. They were Jews in this time who had sold themselves out to the Roman Empire to get this. They basically had to pay to get the status of a tax collector. And once they did, once they had that status, they would extort their own Jewish brethren to cover the cost. So that if Rome said, hey, you, each person owes a denarius, they would charge 2 or 3 or 10. They would extort it, and they got to keep all the extra. And Rome knew that they were scoundrels, so they didn't think highly of them, but then they didn't have to deal with it. And then the Jewish people hated them because they were taking advantage of their own people. They were disregarding their family and their community. They were despised of all those who could possibly be despised. So if you were a tax collector, you were a loner. You didn't have friends. And the only thing you had was the money that you took by extorting your family and friends and neighbors. And it says, and Jesus said to him, he said to him, follow me. And it says that Levi did end up eventually rising and following him. This is a uniquely powerful phrase. To say follow me, see, the rabbi would travel around teaching and the crowds would hear and they would be blessed and they would learn. But if the rabbi chose you to come with him, it was a massive honor to bestow. And it wasn't just, hey, trail along after me and see. It was enter into this way of life with me. Become part of my circle, and I will share all of me with all of you. Jesus was offering one of the most despised people. There would be nothing that would say, hey, if you're trying to build an inner circle to impact the world and create a movement, you get yourself a tax collector. Okay? That's the way to do it. That would have been the opposite strategy of what Jesus should have done. And yet he did it. And here's the thing. What we find in the pages of Scripture is that this is the very same offer that is made to everyone. All of us are invited into relationships. So often we turn it into religion. You got to say the right thing. You got to do the right thing. You got to believe the right things. You got to look the right way. You got to. At the end of the day, there are certain things that, yes, there are rules. Every society has rules. And God and his structure is no different. But those rules are not placed to restrict and keep out. It's to gird up what is right and good for those who have come to love him, who have seen him for who he is, who have stepped into that place of being an heir, a son, a child of the Most High. See, we get relationship and religion confused. And even in our modern day, this isn't just a old world problem. We do it today. Unless you look this way, unless you act this way, you may not be part of our family. And that is totally against what Jesus said. Jesus said, "Come to me, you who are weary and heavy laden. My burden is easy, my yoke is light." Jesus offers all of us the opportunity for a relationship. And the thing is, Jesus offers that. Jesus invites people regardless of their background. That's our second big point. That Jesus invites people regardless of their background. We just saw that sort of with the tax collector. It's going to keep going because we're going to see what happens here in verse 15. It says, "As he reclined at table in his house, many tax collectors and sinners." So this group, you'll see this phrase throughout the pages of the Bible. We already talked a little bit about tax collectors. Do you know what typically when you see this phrase, sinners, refers to? Usually, in this context, it's referring to prostitutes. It's using, because again, they were some of the lowest of the low on the social standing of the day. And now, it's difficult for us because sometimes we, in our context, because we're basically 2 millennia removed from these events to think, well, you know, that was that stuff. You know, we don't quite have that. But you have to understand, we all have our own tax collectors and sinners in our world and our circles. And they might actually be IRS agents or prostitutes, it's possible, but chances are they're other people. Chances are they do other things. Maybe they're of a different political persuasion than you, right? If you're a diehard Republican, maybe it's a Democrat. If you're a diehard Democrat, maybe it's a Republican. If you're a libertarian, it's everybody else, right? Okay? Whatever it might be, it's the other. And that's what we see here. The other we look down on. But the thing is, we kind of push people down to that other. But if we're really honest, sometimes we're the other. Maybe we're often the other. Maybe we're just the other. That we look at ourselves and say, okay, I hear about this God stuff and, you know, I'll listen to a message or I'll show up at church occasionally, but you don't know how bad I am. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I've done. You don't know how I was raised. You don't know what was done to me. And we put ourselves in this other, like, it's okay for all of you. That's good for you, and I want that goodness for you, but I'm too bad. And let me tell you, I literally had this conversation with someone just this past week. It is impossible to outsin God's grace. That's not a license to go and be as wicked as you possibly can and be like, woohoo, I'm good. That's not what that means. But what it means is we do not have to carry the shackles and the shames of shame and guilt that weigh us down and just squish us. We can let go of those because Jesus said, I will carry them in your place. All right? This is what Jesus did. He invited these tax collectors and sinners. And it says that they were reclining with Jesus and his disciples. Now, we might think reclining like, hey, easy chair, legs pop up, you know, we're going to watch a football game. That's not what was going on. This was a picture of what it meant to eat a meal together. Because in this time, a lot of the time, the meals were not at a table sitting on chairs like we would do today. They would literally be at around a low table, and people would sit on the ground and lean their backs into each other to support each other while you're eating a meal. That's what this reclining means. And Gary Jones, who is a pastor of another church and also faculty for the Dallas Theological Seminary, wrote an article around what happens at the table and why Jesus so often utilized the idea of eating and meals together. His article is The Table, Connection, Brokenness, and Blessing. He says, by his own admission, Jesus had a reputation among the religious establishment for being a glutton and a drunkard. We see that in Matthew 11. One of the most distinctive things about him was that he ate and drank with notorious sinners. When the Pharisees called Jesus a glutton and a drunkard, they didn't make up that depiction. They were referring to Deuteronomy 21:20 and implying that Jesus' table fellowship with people who were far away from God made him worthy of death, which was a Jewish understanding of that passage for what God was calling his people to do. But the Lord Jesus, that table fellowship was a demonstration of the inbreaking of the kingdom of God. When Jesus invited people to meals, he was saying, this is what the kingdom of God is like. This was a massively significant thing. This wasn't just like a casual, oh, hey, we should catch a cup of coffee sometime. Let's, you know, go meet up at Starbucks. I mean, you do that if you don't like coffee, you know, but still, it's not casual. What Jesus was offering was something deep, and it was saying, you are okay in my eyes. And who was Jesus saying that to? Tax collectors and sinners. So think about that. Again, maybe from the political persuasion, whatever party or affiliation you have, can you think of, hey, I want to have someone over who completely disagrees with me. I want to feed them and say, you're okay with me. Because that's what Jesus did. This is one of the reasons why one of the applications we put for our whole series with the He Gets Us is invite someone over for a meal. Signify by inviting into your home around food that this other person has dignity and worth simply because they exist and are made in God's image. That's the call that's being put out here when it says that Jesus was reclining with these people. And it says, interestingly, that there were many who followed him. So this wasn't just like a isolated, this wasn't just, well, we let Levi sneak in so we could have our token other person. There were many tax collectors and sinners that were there. And as much as we're invited into relationship and that we're invited to be with Jesus, that it's the invite is made to everyone, Jesus invites everyone to the table. Now, this might seem very similar to what we just talked about, but I want to clarify, because in our world today, we do some of the same things that the religious people, the religious leaders of Jesus' day did. And that is we create, well, there's certain lines where we cross and why they don't belong here. Look, still here in Mark 2, looking and starting in verse 16, it says, and the scribes of the Pharisees, when they saw that he was again eating, this, you're okay. He was giving acceptance to those who were deemed the lowest of the low, with sinners and tax collectors. They said to his disciples, to Jesus' disciples, why does he do this? Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? If he's really holy, if he's really righteous, he should know what they're like, right? You see, what we just said was Jesus invites regardless of background. See, so often we get shackled to our own background and we shackle others to their backgrounds. And what does Jesus do? It says, when Jesus heard it, he said to them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. And this is a little bit of a tongue-in-cheek kind of thing. Jesus is actually jabbing the scribes and the Pharisees here a little bit in the ribs and saying, you know, look at yourself. Because the Pharisees would have said, we've got it together. We are the righteous. We are those who are spiritually well and fit and healthy because we have followed all the rules and we can show off our righteousness. That's how they would describe themselves. They made a show of their religion, but Jesus turns it around and says, you who think you're well, then I guess you don't need me. But that's not why I'm here. I'm for those who recognize that they are sick, that recognize that they're sinners and they need healing. They need hope. They need help. Which is why how we go about our purpose as a church. Our purpose as a church is helping people live Jesus-centered lives. We do it by connecting them to the help, the hope, and the healing of Jesus. That's what Jesus is saying. I came here to provide this. Those who are sick, to help them become well. You see, Jesus invites everybody to the table. Jesus invites everyone to be part of what he came here to create, to break heaven into our world. He came to do that. And now that it's broken in, he's inviting everyone to participate. That's why we can say that Jesus accepts everyone. But let me say this. I said I would circle back to it. This good news of Jesus, this gospel of Jesus, it is two things that at the surface level may seem mutually exclusive. And by that I mean the good news is both inclusive and exclusive. Now let me show you how that fits together, because I believe it does. First of all, it is inclusive because we all have access to it. There is no one in all of God's green earth that is prohibited from being part of God's family. There is no one. It doesn't matter what you believe. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter where you've been, who your parents are, what your country is, what your language is, what your politics are, what your sexuality is. None of that matters. The offer of Jesus is available to all, regardless of any other factor. And in fact, if you look in the pages of Scripture, it says that if anything other than Jesus is made as the, you know, for being offered for salvation, that's anathema, that it's cursed to have anything else. It is available to everyone. There are no other conditions. You don't have to be good enough, smart enough, pretty enough, anything enough, because you can't. Everyone has access. It's available to everyone because of the exclusive nature of it. And that is, it's exclusive because there's only one way to access it. Everyone has access, but you can only access it in a particular way. And what do we mean by that? Well, if you read in 1 Timothy 2, we have the truth that we do all have access. It says that Christ Jesus gave himself as a ransom for all. Jesus' sacrifice, when he died on that tree, a death he didn't deserve, he paid a debt that he didn't owe, and he can offer that payment on everyone's behalf. Not just a select few, not just the really pretty, he can offer it to all of humanity for all time. And yet, if you step to the verse before that, to 1 Timothy 5, it says, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, Jesus Christ, that provides that ransom. If you read in John 14, 6, it says that Jesus said to him, to one of his disciples that was questioning him, he says, I am the way and the truth and the life. Catch this, no one comes to the Father except through me. You see, the ticket in is Jesus, but there's not a limited run of tickets. This ticket is available to all. And there, we can have some side discussions of what does it mean for those who haven't ever heard of it, and what does it mean for those who lived before Jesus. These are all wonderful conversations that we can have. But I want to suggest that throughout the course of all time, of all humanity, that the way that people have been able to come to God is through the exceptionally holy, righteous, magnificent, beautiful, tragic sacrifice of Jesus Christ. So that on the merit of Jesus' sacrifice, that is how anyone comes into God's family. That is the one way to access it. But it is available and offered to everyone. It is both exclusive and inclusive. So if that's true, how do we live out this mission that Jesus has given us? The mission of taking his love, what Bud shared earlier, right? Love God, love others. How do we do that mission out into the world? Because you know what? Historically, the church has not necessarily always done a great job. Okay? We have done some things to mess that up. There's, generally speaking, three ways I think churches and Christians try to do it. The first one is what I would call the evasion technique. And this is one where it's, well, we just have to run away from the world. We circle our wagons. We make sure that no pollution of the world ever gets close. We build the moats, you know, around the circled wagons. And then inside the wagons, we build a castle. And inside the castle, we build a bomb shelter. Because we got to make sure that nothing icky ever touches us. We must evade. And while the Bible does call us to holiness, I think it absolutely rejects Christ's call to impact our world and to make disciples, what we're commanded to do in Scripture. And why do people do it? I think some do it because of fear, right? fear that worldliness might creep into our churches, fear that there's danger out there that we have to protect from, you know, whatever. It's a fearful response. And the one that breaks my heart even more, though, is that some people who have accepted Christ's forgiveness, who've entered into his family, simply don't care enough about those who haven't. And this is so antithetical, I believe, to the heart of Jesus followers, that we highlight it as one of our core three beliefs. We say that rescued people rescue people. That if we've experienced the rescue of Jesus from brokenness, from despair, that we must share that rescue with others. Okay? We can't be those who evade the world. Others think that they need to invade. Have you ever met these people? These Christians who are like, I will take down the world for Jesus. I will punch people in the face in the name of Jesus. I will shout them down in the name of Jesus. Right? Here's the thing. There's lots of movements out there that honestly today are kind of ramping this up. There's some Christian nationalists, I don't know if you've heard that phrase before, that really move this from being being part of God's family to being a political movement, which is not what God's family is about. Now, your faith does affect your politics, absolutely. But we've moved it. We're going to take down the world in the name of Jesus. That's just not, that's not part of Scripture. That's not part of what we're supposed to do. We are supposed to impact our world, but we're not to overthrow it. That is not what we're called to do. You will not find that in the words of Jesus. The only people that Jesus ever pushed back against were religious people who were in positions of leadership and were abusing and pushing down others. There was no big political, we're going to combat the culture kind of a thing. No, it was we're going to transform because of, I believe, what is the right way to do mission, the mission Jesus has. We need to persuade. And I'm giving you a bonus. Because if you saw, I did that pastory thing where you make all the words like kind of end the same way. We got evade, invade, and persuade. Well, the one I really wanted to use was engage, but it didn't end the same way. So you're getting a bonus. You're getting two words here. But because I think they're both involved. See, I believe this is the biblical model. Yes, as followers of Jesus, we're supposed to flee from sin. We're supposed to separate from that. And we should. Our faith should impact how we engage the world, even in the political realm. So it's not that it's disengaged, it's just it doesn't become the primary. But the church is not a bomb shelter, it's a gospel outpost. Okay, the best we can do as a church, the best, is for us to look like Jesus, to do it the way Jesus did. And Jesus engaged the world through his incarnation. Look what Jesus did. Jesus, as the third part or second person of the Trinity, he entered into our world knowing that our world was dirty, broken, and wrong. Jesus could have swept in and knocked down every head of state, could have swept in on, I'm sure it would have been like a unicorn Pegasus with a giant sword and just chopped everything. It would have been like an epic movie, okay? Put to shame every Marvel movie combined, right? It would have been amazing. He could have done it. And how did he come? As a baby. A baby who burped and pooped and farted. Jesus did those things. He humbled himself. He was gentle and lowly in spirit. And yet somehow this Jesus, who could be so humble, this Jesus who didn't resist unless someone was being persecuted and facing injustice, he bore on his own a cost he didn't owe. Somehow we say, yeah, but I need to be tough. I need to beat them down, or I just need to ignore them all. Jesus did not do those things. He engaged and he persuaded. And we do this not to become like the world, but so that we can become like our Lord. We're not trying to compromise and say we're going to look like what the world does. You know, it doesn't matter. No, there are standards. But we're going to do it the way Jesus did. That's what we have to do, church. And that's what we're being called into. Not this religious like rites and rules and all that stuff. We're being called into a relationship with the author of the universe. And that's what we're supposed to reflect. And so here's my big question for you. If Jesus accepts everyone, what is stopping me? We started at the beginning there where we talked about how God shows no partiality. It's repeated five times in the New Testament. And we're called to show no partiality. And yet, if we're honest, we do. I shared this with you before. Just looking at the basic demographics of Ephrata, right? What percentage of white, of Caucasian, is Ephrata? What do you think? No takers, no guesses. What? What'd you say? 85, that's really close. 103. Wait, Tiffany's back, yay. All right, it's about 89% at the last census. So basically, 9 out of 10 people in Ephrata are white. Okay, but that means how many are not white? 1, okay. So if 9 out of 10 are white, 9 minus 10 is 1. Okay, so out of every 10 people, there's going to be one person that's not white. How many not white people are in our church right now? The sheep, buddy! Okay, but even with the sheep here, we average right now about 55 to 60 people on a Sunday. Do you know how many, on average, non-white people we have in our church? 0. Most weeks we have 0. Because here's the thing, we have somehow shown some partiality. We have somehow not bridged out into the broader community so that what happens inside this building reflects what's happening in our community. And we have to just take a look and say, why is that? Why is it that we are so abundantly white beyond what our culture is? Yes, let's admit it. Ephrata is abundantly white. Tiffany said 103% white. I get where that comes from. Okay, and it's not wrong for us to be any percentage white or black, but the thing is it doesn't reflect our culture, so why? Why are we out of touch with our culture? Why are we not reflecting what our culture is? Because if we're reaching our culture the way Jesus called us to, we would reflect those things with who is in this building, with who is connected to our church. And I think we need to push into that, ask those questions. What things are we putting in the way of the gospel? Because if we're putting something between people and the good news of Jesus, we are sinning. So what things might we be putting in front of people to separate them from the gospel? But let me read for you why we should, I believe, accept everyone the way Jesus does. Just listen, I'm going to read some verses from 1 John chapter 4. All right? It says this. We're going to start in verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation, the redeeming sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. Please take just a moment and pray with me. Father, thank you that you have first loved us. Thank you that though we were not worthy, you just poured out your love and your value on us and into us. Thank you that you have esteemed us worth your sacrifice. Thank you for loving us so deeply. May we respond to that love by loving others with equal passion. God, may we love others in your name because you first loved us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.